Good afternoon, everyone. In addition to our wonderful sessions, it's a great privilege and honor to be able to celebrate this wonderful achievement. So Dr. Saxena has, in her full life, engaged with a professional career, a wonderful family, and the whole engagement with the city of Bologna. In addition, she has had a connection to literature from a very early age, and had decided at a stage, when in fact she was most busy, to make another commitment to bringing stories and tales that she was part of into the form of a book. So this whole festival is celebrating this level of achievement, and it's very nice to focus on somebody individually who's actually about to cross that threshold and launch her first book. So I'd like to introduce you to Dr. Saxena. She'll present the press day of her book and then we'll launch it for her. Thank you very much.
Thank you, AILF. Thank you, Arthur Duff, sir. Thank you, Uma Shankar, sir, Pinky Vyas, and the entire team of AILF for launching my debut novel, Natal Fault. First, let me explain this uncommon title in a common way. The word natal, it is derived from the medical terminology. It means pertaining to birth. It is not in the common English usage, but since I am a doctor, so I derived that word as a title for my book. Now, what is natal fault? Natal fault, ladies and gentlemen, is a phenomenon. It is a core idea behind this novel. If natal means birth, basically birth is to be celebrated, then where lies the fault? So now take the case of Rahul Gandhi. These days, the country is going gaga over the religion of Raga, whether it's a Hindu, Muslim, Parsi, or whatever. Take the case of Rohingya Muslims. What is the fault of a child born to a Rohingya Muslim at this juncture? He or she is a countryless child. So that becomes the natal fault. So natal fault is the germ idea or the core phenomenon after my novel. Basically, it has several layers of fiction revolving around this germ idea. And as for the precis of the novel, it is a biphasic novel having a contemporary part and a classic one. The contemporary part starts in the monsoons of 2012 when the protagonist, Dr. Suchitra, who is a geriatrician. Now let me explain to you, a geriatrician is a person who takes care of the elderly, as a pediatrician takes care of the children. So the protagonist is a doctor, Dr. Suchitra. She is about to launch or open a new hospital named after her deceased mother, Rajshree. So she is about to open the hospital, the Rajshree Varma Memorial Foundation. Now, as she is into this process, she encounters several irregularities in the contemporary world, plaguing the medical and the social scene in the country. For example, the social divide, the exploitation of women, the kickbacks they are served to the doctors, so and so on. Also, at the same time, she is intrigued when she starts receiving email from a 90-year-old person from Singapore, Mr. Samarjeet Singh, claiming that he was an ardent lover of Rajshree 70 years back. Now she's dumbfounded. Because you know, these old people sometimes they suffer from some types of illusions, delusions in the form of dementia and other disorders, and they can claim anything which might not be real. So there's no testimony, no proof to this saga that 70 years back this person was actually in love with Rajshree, and he was an ardent lover of Rajshree. So as the novel unfolds or unravels, this mystery also unravels. And then the novel shifts from the contemporary society to the India of 1940s, when the Indian freedom struggle was on and the world was engaged in the once we let me read a paragraph and then we unveil the book. Let Mr. Duff unveil the book and then I'll close for paragraph.
And of course, the whole point of launching the book is that it is not revealed as to what it is, such that you then all rush out and buy the book. So the job of launching one is to celebrate the fact, but also to encourage you to go and buy it. So on this happy occasion, may I launch? Invite you all to take part in our wonderful commitment to bringing this to fruition. So congratulations.
Now this novel, it is a socio-political saga and a beautiful love story is cocooned within it. So it is basically love, war and the social turmoil. So the paragraph I'm going to read here, it covers the war. In this paragraph, it is a part of the email that Samarjeet Singh sends to Rajshri. And where he claims that he was a soldier at the World War II and what the trials they had to face. Now, our heads had ached and our tummies burnt with hunger pangs. We had grown both weak and balmy with hunger. Then something happened. A stray ass slightly whined, ending in a milder heat hole. Smith ruminated, stroked his beard. By that time, we had long beards, mostly infested with lice. He then charged upon the creature, made a gash with a piece of stone that he found nearby, until the poor creature was badly wounded. It was then roasted until the skin charred, crackled, and flesh underneath was just succulent. Smith ate it while it was still raw. I retched with disgust as much as with hunger. He offered me a charred piece from which some straw-colored liquid was dripping. After initial reluctance and resistance, I had it too. We had become savages. It is hard to imagine today why and how we suffered, why the wars were fought at all in the first place. Some questions, though still irk, why men ruled men of other countries? Why did the common man suffer? It's another matter, though, that a common man suffers even today, a part of which it is his natal fault. So this paragraph justifies the essence of the natal fault. And there's a small paragraph, again, this was a part of war, because this book is inspired by the Chindit operation of 1943. And Chindits were an army, infantry army, comprising of the Gurkhas, Indians, Britishers, and it was a mixed army which fought against the Japanese army in the jungles of Burma. So they had to face a lot of troubles, so this paragraph reflects that. Now, what is a small paragraph about love? We were in love without knowing each other much. It was natural, uncorrected, spontaneous, chaste, but it had a matchless power. I was transformed from that very moment. The terrace ledge was a rendezvous. Gradually, she learned to getting down the terrace railing and overcame her inhibition and fear of sitting there with feet dangling in the air. The ledge overlooked a lake with gentle undulating hills and knolls on the other side. In those days, such places were unexploited and oozed a virgin charm. The lake bank was lined by tall, slender, and waving kashpul, or the kas grass, with soft, white, hairy catkins, which swayed inebriated with a breeze interspersed with boughs. The adjoining mud track was lined by golden shower trees, or the amaltas, with pendulous yellow blossoms, and large gulmohar trees with red blossoms, and shady boughs underneath, which dried leaves moved in a flurry when swept by wind or rustled when an agile squirrel hopped, subduing the summer heat. abode was our hideout when Leela, along with Sumit and Neeraj, was out selling plants. Rajshri had answered her matriculation examination and was awaiting result. She often came to the terrace to spread the desiccated spices, red chilies, turmeric, coriander seeds, washed wheat before they were sent to the mill to be pounded. Also, she came to spread woolen clothes, bananas and saris, freshly rolled potato, rice papad, grated potato chips, bari, a type of dried Indian nugget, made from coarsely ground pasted pulses, or to hand dyed clothes. Rural and suburban sunny Indian terraces are spreadsheets for such cornucopia. Gradually, manhood gave me a call. I no longer wanted to be a vagabond. So thank you. Without taking much of your time, I've read out the paragraphs from this book. And as an author, every author wishes that is the read and wants the reader's verdict. So I request you all to read it, rate it, review it, and if you like it, recommend it to others. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Certainly sounds quite a gripping story. Thank you very much. Moving on to our next session,